The trouble with a lot of real-world experiments is that you can't have a control group. If you're researching, say, how riverbanks are affected by erosion, then either you have to observe the erosion happening in the wild with lots of messy variables like weather and climate and wildlife, or you have to rely on tiny-scale models or computer simulations. You can't take an actual river, let it erode its banks for a while, then stop the water, rebuild everything, and just run it again with one thing changed. Unless you build your own river, which is exactly what the University of Sherbrooke in Canada has done. Will you start the pumps, please?
So I've done a lot of studies in nature on real rivers. You do get excellent information, but you can't pick out specific variables and play with them. We built this with the idea that we can study sediment transport on a scale that kind of represents close to, well, a small river or creek. The water starts in the reservoir, the pumps pump from the reservoir, and then it discharges into the approach channel, which is made to be very large so that we diminish any turbulence that might be brought in there by the pumps. After that, we have a weir, and then it arrives in the river and goes down, and that's where we do our experiments. From the river, it falls over an overflow into a sediment trap. From the sediment trap, it goes back into the reservoir. It's a recirculating system. Probably takes 2 or 3 minutes for the water to recirculate. So it is all repeatable. We can adjust the pumps for a certain level, have that one day, come back a week later, and have the same flow coming through the system. We have 2 70-kilowatt pumps. At the moment, we can have 800 liters per second, and we have room for another pump.
Okay, compared to the Mississippi, this doesn't look that big, but here's how powerful it is. We anchored down a GoPro camera to get those shots near the weir, and the water just blasted it away. One of the team here had to wade in to save it before it got washed into the basin, never to be recovered.
Thank you, Basem.
So it does a very good job of representing small rivers, and the processes that happen here are much more related to, say, a river than small laboratories. Obviously, in larger rivers, you have more scales of turbulence, but those scales, they should be similar in our size.
I've seen a small scale model years ago when I visited the Bay model in California. It's a 1 to 1,000 scale copy of the San Francisco Bay, which means it's the size of a football field. But the 1960s engineers who built it had to stick a load of copper strips into the base to make the water behave like it would at full scale. By all accounts, they did really well, particularly for before computers, but it's no comparison to having a model that is closer to real world size.
This summer, we were looking at erosion induced by a bank, an artificial bar we put in. Throughout the world, there's a problem in understanding how much erosion is going to happen for a given flood. So as an engineer, you want to be able to run a model that will tell you how much bank erosion you'll have in the future. We would also next year like to start looking at ice cover and the effect of ice on things like bank erosion, floods, because ice-related flooding is a huge problem. Having a river that where you can model ice would be quite unique.
A lot of this work can be done with computer simulations now, but the code for those simulations still has to be validated and checked somewhere like this. And sometimes the researchers here are working on things that there is no computer model for, which surprised me. I assumed that simulating water was pretty much a solved problem, but no, there are still new technologies that need to be tested. And one of them is up there, getting the aerial shots for this video.
To model this river with a particle interaction model would take many days, months, years to run. We have projects involving large-scale particle image velocimetry. This is a new technique. With a drone, you'll take the water surface and then you can have a velocity which you can then relate to a discharge. How much water is moving through a section of river per second. And having a method of measuring discharge without actually going into the river is very useful because it's very difficult to go into these rivers at high flows. It's very dangerous, in fact. The water surface can be affected just by the general wind, but then that can influence or bias the results of the flow we actually want to measure.
And sure, by the grand scales of water parks and whitewater rafting centers, this isn't the biggest artificial river in the world, but it is one that's built for research. Even if that does mean that the team here wouldn't let me bring my own inflatable tube to ride down it.
Nobody has ever been down an inflatable tube. It's an interesting idea, but I don't think I would advise it.